Homework Hotline is supported in part by New York State United Teachers, working with parents and the community for our children's future. NYSET, a union of professionals, and by viewers like you.
When you have got a question and you just can't figure it out, just give us a shout and call the Homework Hotline, the Homework Hotline, the Homework Hotline, the Homework Hotline.
And welcome to Homework Hotline. I'm Joe Zuniga.
Hi, and I'm Ed Hathaway. Homework Hotline is the place where you can get help with your homework on the phone, online, or on TV.
Now, here's how it works. There's teachers from Dowell Teachers standing by right now to take your call and help you with your homework.
Now, if you'd like help with your homework, call Dowell Teacher Free at 1-888-986-2345.
Now, remember, you can also send us your question to our website. Go to homeworkhotline.org. Just click on the Yak Back button and send in your questions.
All right, great. Now, before we get to tonight's science challenge, we'd like to remind our viewers that a little later in the show, Tim Cawley from the Rochester Museum and Science Center will be here to talk to us about polymers. And now, we will get to that science challenge.
Okay, Ed. Well, if you remember, not last week because it was the Thanksgiving
right.
break, but
two weeks ago.
Our science challenge, we talked about a compass. We had a compass on.
I remember that
so
very well.
So I have another compass here today.
Okay.
And I think most kids have probably used a compass, know that the red part of the needle here, when I have this level, and unfortunately you can't see it when it's level, but that needle will point north.
All right.
We talked
right.
a little bit about magnetic fields last time with Tim and everything.
Okay.
All right. I also have a bar magnet here. And just by coincidence, the north end is red.
Okay.
And the south end of this bar magnet is blue.
All right.
All right. And we know that this north end of this is going to point to the North Pole, right?
Okay.
So my question is, what would happen if I took the north end of this bar magnet and held that up to my compass, to the needle
question.
Of my compass?
Good question. Okay. Mr. Z. All right. Again, the science challenge tonight is, what will happen when Mr. Z places the north end of the magnet near that needle? Now, if you think you can solve this science challenge, give a hotline a call at 1-866-264-5904, or you can just answer at our website, homeworkhotline.org. Answer correctly, and you could have a chance to share the answer at the end of the show.
But remember, every correct response will be at our Homework Hotline Hall of Fame, and if you earn enough points, you could win one of those tablets at the end of the season.
All right, great.
All right.
Well,
we have an email question for me to read to you?
I think we do, and
okay.
I think I'm going to use our old graph board for this one, Mr.
Right.
Z, if you don't mind.
Sounds
so I'm
going
to grab some markers here.
All right, Ed, so you've got a spinner I see you started.
Okay.
And your four colors are red, yellow, blue, and green.
Okay, let me just jot that down. I don't have yellow, so I'm just going to write that in here with that marker. But I do have the rest. What were they, Joe? They were red?
Yellow, blue, and green.
All right, got the red. Put that down. Blue
and green.
And some green.
All right,
Mr. Z, go ahead. What else do you have for me?
All right, so Lydia and Jody had a spinner and made a table from their spins.
Okay.
All right. You're going to make a bar graph from their data table and label it.
All right, hopefully they have some data. Just to remind our viewers, this spinner, it would look something like this. We've all played games with this thing, and as we spin it, it's going to go into one of these four quadrants. And then we'll have the data. And what is that data, Mr. Z?
Okay, the red one came up 16 times.
All right, so red was 16.
Yellow was 8.
Yellow came up only 8 times, okay.
Blue was 12. And green came up 10 times.
All different. Okay, green came up 10 times. Thanks, Mr. Z. So what we're going to do, and this is very common when you do financial data or mathematics tables, just about anything. You do different types of graphs. The directions for this is a bar graph. So let's set it up. We got to make sure that we label them. So I am going to do a kind of an ugly little setup here, almost like your X and Y coordinates. But instead of plotting them in coordinates, we're going to do bar graphs here. All right, let's give them some labels here. Let's call this coordinate down here the colors, and this guy along here the amount of spins that was calculated by each color. All right, so first, and let's try to make it look a little bit more plausible. Actually, you know what, Mr. Z? I'm going to mark them off by fours.
Two, three, four.
There's four. One, two, three, four. There's eight spins. One, two, three, four more. 12. Two, three, four. 16. It's the highest one that we have. So that's where we'll stand. All right, so the red, as you see from that data that Mr. Z read us, had 16 spins. That means when we took this spinner and looking around during all these different spins here, how many do we have a total of? We have 22, 30, 46. Spin it 46 times, 16 of them came up red. So we'll do a red here, and we'll go up to the 16. And fill in our bar. And that clearly shows that as we spin, when we spin that chart right here, we have 16 of them came up the color red. All right, let's use yellow next. I don't have the color yellow here, so I'll have to use the black. That came up eight times. So we'll go here, fill in the bar graph, and let the users know that that was the yellow. And again, that shows that eight spins out of the 46 came up in the yellow area. All right, get a blue marker. All right, label it. Always better, always good to make sure that you fully and clearly label each one. And if you can color coordinate like we're doing, that is always an advantage. All right, so we're gonna do 12 of these. Again, fill in our bar graph so it's easily seen that 12 of the spins came up blue. One more. Let's do the color green. And that came up only 10 times. Now, interesting fact here about the 10. We didn't quite mark it off, but we do know that it's halfway between the 12 and the 8. So there's the 10 right there. We'll go up to it here and clearly mark that with the green. Now again, there's line graphs you can do, pie graphs that you can do, but the directions here clearly said for us to do a bar graph. So we showed this, so we should give it a title. Yeah, so spins per color. Yeah, it's always a good idea to give your whole graph a table or give it a title. So again, this shows us in one viewing how many times we did each spin. Okay? Thanks, and there's a bar graph.
This country is home to the Great Wall as well as one of the world's oldest civilizations. China has always been a country of inventions, and ancient China was no different. The Chinese are credited for inventing paper, silk, porcelain, and gunpowder, among many other things. But the last two decades, China has changed faster than any other country in the world. China is the most populated country on Earth, with 1.3 billion people living here. China is known for its natural beauty, from its mountain ranges to its coastal waters. Mount Everest, the tallest mountain on Earth, sits on the border between China and Nepal. In the Southwest Mountains, you can find the giant panda, which only lives here and nowhere else on Earth. The Chinese government has taken action to protect the wildlife in China due to expanding deserts in the north, deforestation, and overhunting.
Ed, before we get into this, we got to talk a little bit about the science challenge, because I guess there's some confusion on what the question was or what we're looking for. So the question was, what's going to happen to the needle when I put the north end of a bar magnet up to the needle on my compass, okay? So that's what we're looking for. What's going to happen? We want to know what's going to happen there.
Okay. Hopefully that clears it up for some of them, and we'll get some good answers.
Yeah.
All right. Now, but we'll get back to the questions and the science challenge in just a moment. But we'd like to welcome back Tim from the National
Museum.
Hey, guys.
Good to see you again.
Welcome back.
Nice to see you.
Always a pleasure, Tim. How
nice
are you doing?
Nice to see you.
Good. Thanksgiving.
Yeah, I did have a great Thanksgiving.
Good.
And who knows? We're in December already.
Yeah.
Just yesterday, it seemed like it was November.
You're shot by.
All right. So today, what we're going to talk about actually has a lot to do with this.
Water.
Oh, cool.
That's impressive.
Where is it?
Where did that go?
Sometimes it does, sometimes it doesn't.
Yeah.
There you go.
There you go.
Oh, there it is.
Polymers.
Oh, I see what you did.
We're going to talk about polymers. Now, the thing about polymers is how they're connected.
All right.
And they're cross-linked.
Isn't Christmas
it,
colors?
Christmas colors. We went with it. What a hat. Actually, they don't look like this. They more turn around and have more of a clumped look to it. But you can see these have a lot of loose spots. These are much tighter. So that's how the links go.
Great.
It's how polymers, poly, meaning many, mer, meaning one thing. And it's how they're connected together.
I understand.
The building block
poly
would be the monomer.
And one. Polymer, that's so fantastic.
That's exactly.
I never knew that.
Yeah. Exactly.
That's great.
So I was going to say
the building block would be the monomers, meaning one. And so a lot of them stuck together is the
polymer.
Yeah. Polymer. And the most important polymer in the world? Is DNA.
What is it?
DNA. It makes you and me.
And we all have our own original DNA. Right?
Exactly.
Hey.
But today what we're going to do is we're going to do a couple of different things.
Okay.
We're going to first work with these polymers, latex balloons. Now these are loose link because you can fill them up and they hold a lot of air. But what we're going to do is we're going to do the old needle through the balloon trick.
Good luck with that, Tim.
Oh, no. We're all going to have good luck with it. Here's what we're going to use.
Oh, you got one for me over here, too.
Oh, yeah. We're all over this like a cheap suit.
All right.
What I want you to do is take a little bit of mineral oil, and right at the top, you'll see where it all comes together at the top. Now, it may be a little bit askew, but you find that little dark spot at the top. Put about the size of a quarter on there, because oil breaks down oil, and mineral oil will break down the latex. Also go around the bottom, around the knot.
Okay.
Now, that's why I've got all kinds of these paper towels for you to dry your fingers off. And when you're done with that.
I hope I put enough on here,
too. Oh, more than enough.
All right.
Now, you want to, you can take.
You also
with yours,
dip this in
no,
there?
Well, you've got so much, you can just take it and just bring it right across the top.
Okay.
And what you want to do is take the tip of it, put it in, and start to twist back and forth and push forward. Oh,
no, mine didn't work.
You're the only one that's going to get it.
Always the great scientist.
Oh, yeah, second one.
Just in case, always keep one off to the side.
All right.
That's
well. What is this stuff that we're putting on there?
Mineral oil.
And that breaks down.
That breaks down the oil
somehow.
And it lubricates it on the way down.
Lubricates through too.
Yeah.
Now you'll see. You want to do it, Mr. Z? You want me to do it?
I'll try.
Give it a shot.
All right.
You'll see a lot of times magicians will do this, but they'll cheat.
Oh, look at you go, Mr.
If you,
Z.
If you go right to here and just, I always pinch it just before it comes. You got to go over a little bit more. Pinch a little bit.
Yep.
There you go.
There you go.
You should get two tries at everything. Balloon on a stick.
Right.
And the idea is.
Mr. Z.
there's your shish kebab, Ed.
Mr. Z, why does that work?
Well, we talked about earlier, if we had blown our balloon up too much, it wouldn't have. But what happens is the balloon actually tightens down around the skewer and it's keeping the air from escaping.
But if we blew it up too much, what's the difference?
It's just it would be stretched already to its limit and it would pop on us.
It'll pop anyway.
Yeah. Which may have been what happened before. But either way,
it had a little gift.
We got it to work.
Yeah.
And that's it. Now, we've been talking about, you've been calling it one thing or another, but what we're going to work with is Elmer's glue and a little borax and water. And this is a cool one that kids can do at home. You take the borax, you just mix a bunch of borax with water, borax, that powdered soap detergent additive, and we take a little bit of Elmer's glue or whatever type of glue you like, white glue, put it down inside there, and we've got that.
Should we talk about what the glue actually has in it? Why we're
sure.
using, all right. So the glue is a polymer.
Okay.
It has a polymer in it. Okay.
And we're going to take the borax and water, put a little bit inside, and now I'll give it a second.
Oh, you made it a pretty color.
Oh yeah, went with the blue look.
Yeah.
And now when you pull it out, it starts, you can see where it's actually starting to tighten the links.
Okay. Mm-hmm.
And what I'll do
is it because it's becoming more complex?
It's becoming, like that, it's starting to link together. That. So it goes from this one to this one.
Yeah, I can see that.
So okay. It's a great big long string, but now it's forming bonds between the strings. It's cross-linking between the and picture a lot of spaghetti.
It's just a natural reaction between these two elements.
And here's where it gets messy.
Yeah, it does look
I
messy.
Turn around.
I'm glad you're doing it.
And you start to roll. Oh, it's not bad for you. It's non-toxic, of course.
Yeah. Uh-huh.
And we've got it almost there. Put it back. I always put it back into the borax and water just to give it a little more.
Oh, there's still some water and stuff
yep,
in there.
Yep, still some in there.
So what happened? Like the borax that. Is actually linking the two different. There was all these strands of the polyacetate in there. And it's linking those together, so it's forming bonds between the different strands of these polymers.
Okay, and it's just certain solutions, like this borax.
Well, borax and water does it because the borate inside of it, and then you can make a little ball.
All right, cool.
And it's easy, fun to do at home. Kids can do it.
Now, how borax long will it? We talked about this before the show. How long will it stay a nice bouncy little ball?
Yeah, maybe 10 or 15 minutes.
So, what's happened to cause it not to be so
just
bouncy?
Drying out.
Drying out.
Okay, that doesn't mean it's losing any of its polymer characteristics.
Nope. It just dries out. And when it dries out, it just turns around, starts to crack. But it's still pretty cool. You could probably coat it with something to keep it solid if you wanted to make a mobile of the solar system, something like that. You could probably coat it with something to seal it for good.
All right.
But it's kind of cool.
That was very well done, Tim.
So let's talk about what happened in the original with the
sodium polyacrylate.
Mm-hmm.
This is the cool part. This is the same powder that you find in diapers.
Okay. Because I've changed a few of those in my life.
Because you can see the powder, and the powder itself will actually absorb 800 times
the water,
its weight in water.
Oh.
And what happens is it's sodium polyacrylate, so when the water hits it, the sodium separates, and that leaves the polymer. The sodium stays inside of the cage, basically, the polymer, and the water is on the outside. Through osmosis, that's where the water is going to go through a membrane. It's always the solvent, which is the water, goes into the sodium, so it keeps drawing in the water till it gets a level where it's equilibrium outside.
There was always that water.
You could dry this out and reuse it. Uh-huh. It will eventually dry out and you can reuse it again.
Yeah.
This whole experiment all over again, if you like to.
But they first started using them. It's been around for a while, but in 73, they started using them for spills. They make giant sandbags out of this, reusable sandbags. Uh-huh. So you set it down, and as the water comes in, fills up, stacks them up. They're easy to move. Then you pull them off to the side.
Water comes back. Great.
So that's polymers. Cool. Well, not everything, but it's cool.
Yeah, we like doing polymers, Tim.
I shake hands with you, but maybe not.
All right, we want to thank Tim for being here. Now, if you want to see this experiment again or learn more about the Rochester Museum and Science Center, head to our website, homeworkhotline.org. But stay there, and we'll be back in just a few seconds.
All right, thanks, Tim.
Thanks, Tim.
Need help with your homework? Call Dial a Teacher for free at 1-888-986-2345. And don't forget, Dial a Teacher is open Monday through Thursday from 3:30 to 7 p.m.
All right, Ed, we have a chemistry question. I'll have you read to me when I get to the board.
You guys are on a roll with your chemistry stuff today. All right, now forgive me, Mr. Z. I'm not a chem major like you, but here we go. This one says, how many milliliters of 2.0 moles? Is that right?
2.0, is it a capital M?
Yeah, they want to know, first says, how many milliliters of 2.0
M? Molar.
Molar. Okay. H2SO4 are required.
Yep. Okay.
Are required to neutralize 60 milliliters of 1 molar.
And okay. Then, 60 milliliters of 1 molar?
Of 1 molar. 60.0, it says here, yep. And then it's got N small a OH.
Okay, sodium hydroxide. All right, let's talk about this a little
bit. Thank you.
Well, we have the H2SO4 is sulfuric acid. So what we have here is an acid and sodium hydroxide as a base, a strong acid and a strong base. So we know acids and base will neutralize each other, and in the formation of that, they'll form a salt and and water, all right? But we want to know how many mole or milliliters of the acid we need to neutralize this amount of the sodium hydroxide, the base. Now, there's two things that we have to look at. We have to look at the volume, and we know the volume of the sodium hydroxide. We have 60 milliliters, okay? And we have to look at the concentration. And the concentration is what we call this molarity. So Ed read that this was 2 molar H2SO4. What that's telling us, molar means moles per liter, we'd have 2 moles, which is a measurement of amount of the sulfuric acid, the hydrogen sulfate, dissolved in a liter of water, okay? Here, the 1 molar sodium hydroxide would be 1 mole of sodium hydroxide dissolved into the liter of water. So the molarity gives us the concentration, the volume gives us how much of it we had. Now, because these are both strong acids, or a strong acid, strong base, we're going to assume they neutralize each other in a 1-to-1 ratio. So the form we use when we do this is the molarity of the acid, okay, times the volume of the acid is going to equal the molarity of the base times the volume of the base. So let's talk about that formula a little bit. If we take how much we have of it and multiply by its concentration, and same with the base, when those are equal, it'll be neutralized, all right? So remember, molarity is our concentration. That was moles per liter. Okay, times liter is going to give us just moles here. And the same thing on the other side, moles equals moles. Remember, we said moles was an amount, okay? So let's go back. Our acid was the H2SO4. We know its molarity. So if we substitute in our formula, 2.0 molar of the H2SO4 times the volume, that's our unknown, will equal the molarity of our base, which was the 1.0 molar times the volume of the base, which was the 60.0 milliliters. All right? Luckily, these are easy numbers because we're going to run out of room here. But 1 times 60 is going to give me 60. I'm just going to do the numbers here. Okay? And 2 times my volume will give me what we have on this side. Divide both sides by 2. And what we're going to see then is the volume of our acid would be equal to 30 milliliters. Okay? So that makes sense if we look back. Notice the acid was twice as strong as the base, so we should only need half as much. So this was an easy one. You could have seen it right there. But this is the formula that will work with anything when kids are doing this in chemistry. So great. That's a great question to get. I'm glad we got this one.
Here's a fun saying to help you remember the basic needs of the human body. Oh, can Venus flies make pretty webs? This actually helps you remember oxygen, carbohydrates, vitamins, fats, minerals, protein, water.
Ed, we've got a winner in our science challenge.
All right.
Hello, Brian, are you there? Hello?
Yes.
Hi, Brian. Brian, tell me what's going to happen here. Here's my compass, right? And I've got my north end of my compass needle is red here. What's going to happen if I put this red north end of my bar magnet up to it?
North?
Mm-hmm. What's going to happen?
If you place the north side of the magnet to the red needle, mm-hmm. And we know that the compass the red needle points to the south. And if you put the north side of a magnet, it faces the north.
Okay. No. Actually, what happens is the needle, this red part of the needle is gonna face north. Okay. And the reason that it's actually attracted to the North Pole is this is the south end of this magnet. Now, we know opposites attract, and charges are going to repel. So since that is north, or if we put the north up there, like you said, that's going to repel. It's going to, see if I can flip it again so we can get it up there. So now watch what I put that over there. Notice it's going to flip it over. Oops, it's stuck too far over. And you're right, the south end came up. If I flip it to the south end, it comes back this way.
So it doesn't go in the middle, like to the west or the east.
No.
It does completely the
And,
opposite.
You know, this is, Tim talked two weeks ago about the magnetic fields. Remember, we had that nice little demo?
Okay.
And so the magnetic field for the Earth comes out of the South Pole and into the North Pole. Magnetic North and South Poles.
Yeah.
And so this needle lines itself up with those magnetic field lines.
I see. That's interesting, because I thought the two would battle, and so they would kind of go east or west.
Oh,
but
nope.
Still, you get the dominant one here.
All right. Well, congratulations. But don't forget, every correct response goes in our Homework Hotline Hall of Fame. Now, if you're in enough points, you could win one of those tablets at the end of the season.
All right. Now, that's all the time we have for tonight. We are going to say goodbye. But remember, Dial the Future is available with free homework help on the phone until 7 tonight.
Now, Monday on Hotline, the University of Rochester Yellow Jackets, my alma mater,
all right,
will be on set performing live.
Good night.
Homework Hotline is supported in part by New York State United Teachers, working with parents and the community for our children's future. NYSET, a union of professionals, and by viewers like you.